stuff with Jorge? Do you have any questions that you may be thinking right now after his talk? Anything that you would prefer to be covered more in depth? Or any question that you brought here to CakeFest that you would like answered right away so I can go in that direction? You do? Yeah.
Are we going to cover that?
Tomorrow.
Okay.
Yeah. You. Some of you.
I
mean, I'm not starting, but just to have it in mind so I can answer at some point.
Sure. Composing multiple contain clauses.
Okay. Yeah, it was you who tweeted, right?
Yeah.
Okay. That's a possible enhancement, so. I have never used it that way. It's like, well, yeah, makes sense. Like, looking back at my code, it's like, I have never done that. It's impressive. But yeah, I can understand that you would like that. Any other thing that you would like to cover?
Callbacks.
Callbacks of, like, models and... Okay, yeah. Anything else? So I have that in mind? Nope. Okay. So I guess you're familiar with Cake 3 now, somehow. How many of you have greeting an app already with using Cake 3? Quite a few. OK. How many of you are actually familiar with the ORM? Sort of. Slowly getting there. It's a lot of stuff, right? Any particular thing of the ORM that you think is complicated should be explained like more in depth?
Migrations.
Migrations, okay, that's a good one. Oh, you want me to repeat? Yeah, if there's any question about the ORM or any aspect of the ORM that looks difficult to you or you haven't actually grasped so far, so I can explain it more in depth today. Okay, yeah, that's a good question. I'm gonna address like quick on that. If yeah, you have another one. Yeah.
I really missed array data sources that works in Cake 2. And I've read Mark Story's posts online as to why he took them out, and they were messy, and I understand that. But it would really be nice to get some documentation how to create just a very simple array source, data source to use as a model.
Okay. We can do that. Maybe tomorrow, yeah, so I can prepare something for it.
Okay.
Fine. Okay, so the most common question is, how do I use the ORM so it's not an ORM? That's great. That's amazing. So let's go over the basics, right? So we're everyone on the same page. I have an application here. I'm using actually the example from last year, so people that were here probably will look at some of the stuff that I covered. Sorry, it's out of focus. Yeah, well, I will need to revert to like crappy display. Yeah.
Have a display adapter you can connect to that. I assume that's a monitor behind your screen.
Yeah, it is. Okay, well, that's it. Let me try that.
That way
so, not mirror. So,
there we go. And then down in the, oh, I'm sorry, yeah, there it is.
Yeah, not mirror.
And so then that way you've got two different displays. Yeah.
Yeah, let me just put it here. I'm sure this is the best way. No, it's not gonna work because I need to watch at the screen. So I'm just gonna stick with crappy. No, it's fine. So it's mirroring now? Yeah. Okay. So, well, I have this application. Can you hear me fine? Yeah. Local connecting. Well, I actually have it here. Let me see if I can put it like this. Okay, so I have this very simple database. It has cities, countries, languages, and a fence log. I'm actually trying to drop this one. I'm not going to need it right now. So it's a world database from the MySQL page. It's a standard one. I changed it a bit so it follows cake conventions. So lowercase, it has an ID, all the tables. It's not integer IDs, but it still works. And I baked a simple application. If you're curious about the datasets, you can go to github.com. Lorenzo, KPHP 3 examples. That's from last year. Let me see if I can connect somehow. Where is the Wi-Fi?
Tap to the binder so you can see other menus. It's because your menu, top menu is too wide, so just go to the binder and then you'll see the Wi-Fi.
You're a pro.
I used to work for Apple. So.
Okay. And it's not available because you hate me. Try one. Hacker News. Something I never go to. Hacker News. Oh, there you go. That worked. The password, you have it here. Just share it with someone. Well, mine is, if you're curious, is Y0 big M 8 at. So I'm waiting. While I wait, so I can show you where to download the schema from, I'm just going to show you real quick the application. So in the source, I have basically right now only these three tables. I have cities, countries, and languages. Okay. So the cities has it belongs to countries. And countries, let me go to languages first. Languages also belongs to countries. And countries has many cities, has many languages, and has one official language. Okay? Do you follow that so far? Simple enough. Okay. So your first friend when working with cake will be bin cake console. Anyone familiar with that already? Who's familiar with that? Great. So cake console is a REPL. A REPL is basically a shell or a console that in which you can write PHP commands and use CakePHP classes as well without the context of a web environment. And if you get a fatal error or if you mistype something, it won't just die. It will just say, oh, you had an error, you can continue, and the state of everything you did before is going to be preserved. Okay? So for example, if I say A equals B, I say B, if I inspect A again, I get B. If I make a mistake, I get an error, but it doesn't die. I just get the same, and I still have the same state as before. Okay? So that's simple. So for working with this console, I would recommend, we're going to work with tables right now. So I would recommend that you alias classes to something that is easy to type. So in my case, I have class alias. I'm gonna alias the cake ORM table registry to just T. Are you following what I'm doing here? Yes. So if I say class exist T, I get true because I declared a new class called T, but which is actually the table registry. Okay? So if I say T get countries, I get a countries table. Is enough?
Just a question.
Yeah.
How do I get the PHP console?
How do you get the KPHP console? I'm in a normal KPHP repo. That's standard. If I type bin slash cake console, okay. I get it. If you just type bin cake, you get a list of consoles.
So I would download this from your examples page, right?
Yeah, you can do that. I think I can get now to KPHP, KPHP. Sorry, it's Lorenzo. KPHP 3 examples. So here you have in config schema world SQL, you have the database that I use. It's KPHP 3 examples. It's going to be so fun in the stats of GitHub that I visit a page with a resolution of 800 by 600. It's like, who the does that? Oops. Let me remove this from here. Doesn't die. Okay, so K console, class alias, I get table countries. I'm going to assign that to a variable so I can work with it. A, or just let's call it countries. Countries equals, I'm going to set. Not very comfy. Can you hear me fine? Yeah. So I assign countries to a variable. I can verify that I have it here. So yes, it is. So let's do our first find. Okay? What happens, now that you have worked with Cake 3 for a while, what happens if I do can't refine? What? It's a find all. And what does it return? Well, yes, it's an iterator, but it's a query. Exactly. It's not the results. It's not the results at all. I get this, and I get an ORM query. If I do it again, I get another query, but nothing has happened in the database so far. Okay. So a lot of people do this. So I get, for example, results equals find, and they go do results. What happens there? It's still a query. So most beginners would say, where are my results? Sad face. That's the reason I added the help here, saying, this is a query object. To get the results, execute it. But if you come from K2, you would actually appreciate that it's not still executed, and you get the select query for it. So you know exactly what is going to be executed. You know that you built your thing correctly. You didn't have to wait 40 seconds if you did it incorrectly because you have a bad join or something. And you can actually see that the params are being passed correctly, etc. And then when you're ready, I have results here still. It's a query. And now how do I get the results? Okay, I got plenty of answers. It's like to array, first, all of them are valid. So all is actually execute the query and get me a? It's not an array. It's a collection. It's actually a result set, but it works like a collection. So a result set is just a collection that comes directly from the database. If I call again, and again and again, you can see it's actually the same object, right? It's not that it's calling the query multiple times. Okay, now I have all, but I can also let me say results all. So I reassign it. So now I only have a result set, not a query. So results. How do I get the first result, for example? First. And what is the return value of that? It's an entity. In this case, it's a country entity. If I want to know what is inside the country entity, I just say debug first. And I get this. It's quite lengthy. I don't usually like it because it's quite lengthy. So what I do is, and this is your first pro tip, you do this. And you get a nice JSON object of your entity. See? this is quite handy, but it has a gotcha, right? Because you can alter in your entity how the JSON export will look like. So sometimes you would say, well, why isn't that column there if I selected it? So it's not there because in your entity you said it should be hidden. So use that with caution. Remember that if you convert to a JSON string, it will actually possibly hide some columns. But if you're just like iterating fast and not yet into that level, you want to see your results, just convert them to string. That is equivalent to doing this. First, how do I get an array of an entity? To array. So you have an array. It looks similar. And it actually has the same gotcha that the JSON has. Because you can actually hide columns when converting to array. So in general, the safest is to just call first and debug that. If you don't want all the verbose stuff, like having if it's new or modified, getting the accessible fields and all that, you just convert to array or just do string of the entity. Good. So what else can we say about results? Someone said that it's a collection. What does that mean? It's an array on steroids. So that means that I can do this? Poo, fatal error. No, you can't. Yeah, it's an iterator. So if you want to do that, so you just say to array 0, right? You get the first country entity. Do you have an idea why you cannot do this? Or why is it can actually be implemented, but why don't we do that? Sorry?
I've seen it implemented that way where you can do either or with the iterator.
Yeah. Well, it's not implemented like that because there are some key features of the ORM that actually contradict this feature. One of the features is that you could opt in into buffer results. So you have a database with a million rows. To be able to get row number 100 means that you have to get all the results and then point to 100. And the other reason is that results, and we're going to see that feature later, results is, you know it's a result from the database, but you don't actually know how it looks like. What is a case of that? If I do results combine, for example, ID and name, and then call to array, I have this, right? So it is actually valid for the table or for the ORM to return this format in your app. So directly from a query, I can actually return that format. Do you know how, for example? Find list. So if I go back to let me find it. Countries find list to array. Broken pipe. That's not fun. I need to configure something on my PHP. So it's gonna bite me a few times during the workshop, so excuse me. Actually, Boris was better. It's the other way. Cake, ORM, table registry, T. Countries equals T get. Countries find list to array. So as you can see, this is exactly the same structure, but out of a find. So if I just do this, I get a query. If I do first all, I get a result set. Actually, it results at the creator, but it's the same. So the reason we don't allow this is because we never know. So out of this, we can say something interesting. Countries find all. Let me get the results variable again. So fast. Well, I need to spend some time fixing that. hopefully it's gonna fix it. So back to my class alias. I need my countries table. Result is final. Okay. So back to that. We said that results was a collection. What does that mean? How do I get? And we know how to get the first, right? It's first. How do I get the second? Any idea?
Limit and offset.
Limit and offset. Yes. What are the collection methods for limit and offset? Okay, the collection methods for that is, well, I don't want the first one, I want the second. So just get the first. That's the second one. So let me call to array so you can see. So this one is Afghanistan. And if I don't skip, this is Aruba. Any questions so far? So my first question to you is, where do I find all the collection methods?
API.
Nice. Actually, in the book, all the collection methods are listed already. Or listed. If I'm not mistaken, let me see here. You can trace buffer, clear exit. You can say ls functions of cake collection. Let me see. No, it doesn't do that. Well, I'm not too familiar with this, but there's a way with this that you can list all the functions of something. Yeah, I think so. Well, so this is how you get the first, this is how you get the second, and there's another way, which is you can say take only one, but after skipping two, for example, that would be the third. You still need the first. Okay, so this is a third country, which is Angola. This is another way of expressing it. Okay, tell me if I'm going too slow or too fast, or this is not interesting, so I can skip this. You're fine?
Real quick, if you wanted to debug an entire result set, not just the first one?
An entire result set?
Yeah.
Well, ideas for debugging an entire result set? There's a super simple one. Ideas? This is the simplest, right? You get your array, you get all the countries. You can debug here. You will have a giant array of all. Yeah, you can do that. You're actually in line with my next step, so that's funny. So, JSON result, JSON encode results. You get it like this. It's not very readable, so you do this. JSON pretty print. And you get it. Okay. So my next step, yeah. What the functionality is to the collection itself implements JSON serializable, which means that it knows how to put everything so it's serializable, and the entities themselves are also serializable, so you get that like on cascade. Actually the created and modified in this case are also time objects, but you don't see here that it's an object, you see a string. That's because it also implements JSON serializable and it converts to a string. So this will be my first addition to Cake, to my app. We're gonna do this a lot. We're gonna do JSON encode, JSON preview print to see results. Because it's handy, isn't it? So I'm gonna create in config bootstrap CLI. I'm gonna create function PJs. So my function PJ. This is horrible. It takes some data and it returns JSON encode data. JSON pretty print. Okay. So if I close here and reload, whoops, cannot redeploy. Oh, we have PJ already. That's amazing. Who put that into the core? Do you know, Mark? Who added PJ to the core? Okay. I was asleep then. Let me get the table again. Probably, yeah. I should go to a workshop and learn about it. I need a query, which is result SQL something. There you go. So I do PJ of results, and I get that. PJ stands for not just pajamas, but print JSON or pretty JSON. It's actually going to save me a lot of time. Okay, good. Any other question about the result set? So how do I get the last one? Last. This actually reads... No, it's actually fine. The last... Oh no, this actually reads awkward because you need to say last and then first, if I'm not mistaken. No, it's not. It's just last. Fuck. That's what I'm going to do. I'm just going to put this in my bootstrap because I'm repeating myself way too much. Now I have T. And okay, so results last. I get the last country if I convert to array or just to string. I get this, right? It's not pretty here, but to array it looks better. Okay, so the last one is Zimbabwe. Good. What else can I do with results? apart from getting a particular result. Okay, what else can I do with a result that is not just getting the first result? I did an example before. I can convert it to something else, like combine, right? I could combine the ID with the name, and then to array, and I get that. Sorry? Format results is actually from the query, not the results. So we're away from that. What does combine do? So if we get the first, I'm going to show you. So this is the first one. The first one has an ID. It's called ABW, and it has a name, for example, Aruba. And I want to create a list that says ID, name, ID, name, ID, name. So I use combine for that. So I can say results combine ID with the name and to array, and I get that. Or I can say ID and population, and I get the population. Yes? Exactly. It already has a result in memory, and it just creates something. So that's actually a good question, because what happens if I do this? Well, you already know the answer because you have seen me do this like 100 times. So I have this. Results combine. So fine. Now I results combine, and I want to sum the population. Sum of something, right? Or sum of, right? Because it should be the value. The value is there, so it should be sum of. Sorry, results. This should get me a number, right? Sum of, okay. Function, I should add this to the core. E, return E. So the same element should be summed, because that's the value, right? Make sense? Well, it doesn't work because I get entities. Why is that? If I convert it here first, results combine, and then I say results sum of the elements. Why doesn't it work? You have seen me do this 100 times, so you have the answer. Maybe the question is not clear. Sorry? I need to save it to a variable. That's actually the answer. So every time we call a method on collections, it returns a new collection. It's not the same collection, it's a new one. Actually, if you see here, if I do combine, you can see the numbers change right here. That's because they're different. So if I want to combine them, or if I wanted to get the sum of, let me get this function, which is the identity. We're going to use this a lot, so I'm going to put it here at some point. Function identity. So if I want to do this, now I get the sum of all the world's population. Does that make sense? I can chain it because combine returns one instance of another collection, and then over that collection, I can sum. But results, which is the original collection, is still untouched. And the collection here, this intermediate one that did combine, disappeared. It's not used anymore. Does that make sense? So something to keep in mind is that collections are immutable. So anything that you do to the collections is not like a query. Queries is like a builder. It will gather all the changes until you execute them. But a collection returns a new one all the time. Any questions so far? Sure, I can do this. In this one here, right?
Yeah.
I can say E population, and it get the same. But of course, that's actually done for you. So you say sum of population, and it's exactly that function. That string here internally is translated to this function. That's what it does. Okay. So I think that's a good way of starting with collections. You know the basics now of what a collection can do and what it cannot do. And you can stack methods on it, as you can see. You can say combine and then sum of and then more and more and more and more. So that actually it's like a pipeline. So you can say, for example, results, I want them grouped. So let me just get to array so you get an idea of what we're going to do. Let me just PJF this. So I have this, right? I have ID, name, continent, region, etc. So I want to get the count of continents, right? So what I do here is results, I group by continent. Let me do a PJ of that. So now they're grouped by continent. I have Antarctica here. Yes, that's a continent. Oceania. So now I have grouped them by continent. Make sense? Okay. So how many continents do I have? How do I get the count of a collection? No, not really, unfortunately. If I do count, it's going to die. Well, yeah, it's one because the count of a not something that is not false is one. Count by, oh yeah, you could do results count by continent. And you should get to array. And you get this, right? So imagine that we didn't have count by, because we just want to know how many results are in the collection. So we have results. And I have group by continent. So the actual method to call is iterator count. That's in the standard PHP functions, the SPL. So I get 7 continents. That was my actual question before. So how many continents do we have? I have 7. Okay. Count by will tell me the count of elements per group, but I wanted to know in general how many elements did I have in the collection. So the answer is iterator count of that. I said it's unfortunately not like that because collections, and that's my next question, my next thing to show. As you can see, when I say collection to array, I get keys, right? They're not numeric keys. So that's a weird thing about PHP, that arrays are both dictionaries and arrays and sorted maps, and it's crazy. It's handy, but it's crazy. So to array is an alias for to map, right? I get the names. But to list is give me only the values. It's like positional array. I don't care about the strings here. I only care about the values. So can you think of an example where I can get duplicated keys? I'm gonna create a fictitious example. So I'm gonna create a collection, which is 1, 2, 3, and I'm gonna map it. It returns the element. Actually not gonna map it, I'm gonna unfold. Unfold. So for each one, I will get past the 1, and then we're gonna pass 2, and then gonna get past 3. What I'm gonna do here is gonna duplicate the numbers. So I'm gonna do for each, maybe not that complex. Let me just yield 2 numbers. So yield E and then E plus 1. Yield E plus 1. Sorry. Do you know what yield does? Yeah, it's like it's a generator. It's like returning another collection inside. So it's a super fast way of generating collections. So unfold, what it does is it allows you that for each element, it allows you to return a new collection, and it will flatten it. So instead of putting arrays or elements containing collections, you will get a flat collection with all the elements from all the collections that were emitted. So if I say to array, I get 3 and 4 for some reason. And yes, that's why. Why do I get 3 and 4? The keys, exactly. Yield actually emits its key value, and the keys that I'm being emitted are always 1 and 2, or 0 and 1. Sorry. So a pro tip is that when you don't actually care about the keys, always, always, always call to list. How do you use that at your advantage? I see you're like suffering.
No.
Okay. Do you have any questions?
I'm just not used to using PHP in console. So.
Oh, okay.
That's all.
Can we get the lights back? It's like getting intimate. Ooh.
Well, you could have 2 arrays. 1 array is integer, you know, keyed array of your continents, and you know you've got that, and then now you know your collection, so then you can say for while you're going for each through it, the key of reference the key in the other array and pull out.
Yeah, okay. There are 2 ways of getting advantage of this. The first way is that you know that 2 array will collapse duplicate keys into something that is at the end, right? So that's a cheap unique. So if you want the unique elements of a collection, so I have this. Like 1, 1, 2, 2. I'm just gonna yield E. So same key, same element. I'm not gonna make it that confusing. I'm just gonna do actually let me do it like that. E. E. Yes? What command?
Yield,
it will return a collection of elements. As many times as you call yield, it will create a element in that collection. So if I call yield twice, it creates a collection with 2 elements. So if I put yield in a for each, it will create as many elements as a for each element has.
Okay.
Okay? So yield EE to array, I get 1, 2, 3. But if I do this, I want the unique elements 1, 1, 2, 2. That's a cheap way of doing unique. You following? Okay. If I can explain it again? Oh yeah, sure. I can do to list. Same list. Nothing happened. So this is a cheap way of doing unique. And another thing is that you can actually put objects as keys. So I can say here, new, let me see, whatever, new country. Not new, whatever, STD class. Right? To list, it doesn't whine, but if I do to array, it whines because it cannot convert a standard class to a key. So why would it be useful to put objects in the keys of something? Any idea? Let me assign this to a variable. So A, each, I get the element and the key. Yeah, sorry. So you can actually get the key when iterating. So you can actually do that in a for each as well. I use this a lot, to be honest. When I'm, for example, parsing CSV files from different sources, I yield a new, I have a task, which is parse 5 CSV files. So I yield the first file, the second file, the fourth file. But the key that I yield for each file is a meta object with like options for parsing. So when I do the each, I get the key and it's like, why? What are the options for this file? Well, it's this one and this one is this one. So as long as I emit the same key, I can get through the iteration change, I can get all the options. But I'm getting too advanced now. So let's go to queries now. I think we covered enough of collections. Any other questions about collections so far? No? Is it confusing? A little bit? Yeah, I know. No questions? Fine. So we have, again, our countries table. We can find. We have 239 countries. So did you get how to make custom finders with Jorge? How do you do that? So guide me. The new way, definitely. How do I create a custom finder? And what finder would be interesting to have? What question can we ask about the world? We have all the capitals in the world, all the countries. We have the language they speak. What would be interesting for you to know about the country or the relationship between two countries? Countries that speak English, that's a good one. So function, public function, find countries speaking something, right? It gets a query and some options. So if empty options language, I'm going to throw an exception, throw new invalid argument exception. You need to provide a language. Okay, so I'm just going to do some checking that you can pass a language to this function. And now we have the query here. What do we do with the query? So we know that a table is related to languages, many of them, but they also have official language. Do you want to know countries that officially speak English or that speak English as part of the population? Okay, so we're going to use this one, right? So query contain. I'm making a mistake right now, so you can correct me. Exactly. Okay. Languages. I'm creating a second error in a minute, so you can correct me. No, it's plural. I'll let you know when I have made the error, so. So you don't just like, is that one? No. And get a query here. So return query where languages dot, let me see what is in the languages table. Languages as a name, dot name, so now put an array here, is English. Does it look fine? I made the mistake already. I'm going to run this query. Let me see if I can get the table registry. What I miss about the other console that we have is that I could do control R. In this one, I cannot do it. Countries. So countries. How do I use that? Find. What should I put here? Exactly. Country speaking. Now that I think about it, it's kind of stupid that in the countries table, and I put countries here, but we can fix that later. Countries speaking. And if I do that, I of course get an invalid argument exception. Please provide a language. Nice, I can provide it now. So, we didn't use this variable for anything before, so that was the first mistake. English. Let me go. Oh, yeah.
You had the
exactly. So PJs of that. Fail query JSON serialize. For real? Like for real. Well, that's odd. That's not normal. Can you look at that, Mark? Cannot call query JSON serialize? We do have JSON serialize in the query. Okay, so languages that name in the word class. Maybe I'm doing something stupid. Let me just debug the query. Ah, fuck. Something's wrong with the keyboard. So I have this. Select countries, all that. There's no languages there, which is the actual problem that I made, right? But what I'm surprised is that languages.name doesn't exist. Name is here.
Is your relation languages or language for the container?
It is languages. Mm-hmm. Let me try again. Let me actually remove as well, now that I have time. Remove countries, so I just say speaking. Console. So countries table. Speaking. English all. Lowercase where? No, well, it's the same, yeah. I'm surprised about this. Let me just remove languages here. Something so odd. So languages. Yeah, let me do something quick, which is figure out what is languages. Is a non what? Yeah, I know, but still. Okay, yeah, that is the bug that he made. But I wanted to show you that it would get all the countries and only the languages that were JSON. That was the bug that I wanted to make. But still, what I'm experiencing should not be happening. Languages, find. Which is first?
Languages,
thank you. Okay, so there's no name for some reason, and I can see it here, so I'm going crazy. Whoa. Yeah. Okay, now I can do that. So, I get countries, and finally, I get PJ of all. So I have all my countries, which is not what I wanted. I have countries and some have like empty languages and some have English, which is not what I wanted. That's the bug that you should have corrected me, but you actually figured out at some point. So how do I actually filter? So you said that I should get first the languages?
Yeah, run it on the languages and then just do a reverse association.
Okay, one way would be to query from languages to tables and get the results, but it's not exactly what I want because I want, like in the top level, I want the countries. I don't want the languages. It's a correct answer though. Mm-hmm. Someone that is familiar with cake tree, please. Yeah, matching. So I just need to change here matching. Matching. I remove this. Okay, what does matching do? It matches. So get countries and boom. I have only languages. Only countries speaking that particular language. What was the problem with? Okay, I'm gonna change it back, right? So I have contain. And I have all countries. If I do an iterator count of this, it gets all the countries in the world. It found all the countries, but with exception that some countries here have the language, which is only English, because that was my condition, but some have it empty, which means they don't speak English. But that's not what he wanted. They only wanted the countries that actually spoke English. So I change it back to matching. and it gets 60, which is a lot. I'm surprised. Mm-hmm. Okay, what it actually does is instead of doing a separate select for getting the languages, it creates an inner join. Boop. This is not a count. So if I debug this, you can see here, inner join languages.
Now, if I wanted to compose two matchings.
Yeah, well, that's another question. But you can actually, if you know how to do it, you can submit it as a pull request, and I gladly accept it. It's not like it was designed that way. It's that I have never used it that way, not when you mentioned. It's like, well, makes sense. Exactly. To answer that specific question without having to change the core now.
Yeah,
what I do is like I make my queries be like a command thing, right? So I actually made them as use cases. So the use case of a particular case mine is find users for newsletter. So for that particular case, I need to get this particular data. So internally, what I do is that in this matching, like in the big matching, like the one that is composed as a use case, I do queue find for newsletter. And then that one contains all the conditions that I need for that. I think that's the reason I haven't used that, is because I have thought the query to be like a command thing where I can compose my way. Like
that was our internal solution, was writing that we were hoping there was a better one.
Okay. No, but it can be included. Yeah. There's no problem. Okay. Oh yeah, and the second bug was I expected language, but I'm not using language anywhere. How do I use it? I guess I here. I use options. Language. Is that correct? Thank you for stopping me. I need to use a variable, which is a PHPism that I don't like. But that's what he have. For people not super used to closures and how they work, what does it do, the use? Yeah, it imports variables from outside the scope. So most PHP programmers do JavaScript, right? So that comes from for free in JavaScript. So every time you do a new function, it inherits the scope that it's in, which creates other problems. Like now you need to map this to self or this to that. But in PHP, you need to explicitly pass it the scope. Fine. Let me see if it worked. Countries. People speaking English. All. Let me go to BJ. So now I have this, and now it's a variable. I can say people speaking Spanish. How do I get the amount of people speaking Spanish? Nope. That's the amount of countries. Yeah, you had a question.
Just a quick question about use. What's the difference between that way versus
Well, the difference is that for passing a parameter, you would need to make a real function, not a, not a magic find.
Yeah, yeah.
Because find, what it does is it only accepts two params. And anything that you want to pass extra goes into options. Exactly. Just like a side thing, I have this query, right? Oops. Query. It's a query object. How do I get the original options? How do I get this back? That's a gotcha for some, including myself sometimes. The query remembers the options that you give it. So try to make your finders either accept unique arguments, unique names, or that all your finders, which is what I do, when they accept one specific argument, they all do the same. For example, I used to do this. From date, and I pass a date object. So I most of my finders will accept a from date thing. So I only need to pass it once to the first finder, and then they every time I say find something else, it will still have the from date. So I have contract speaking Spanish. How do I get the count of people? Or not the count, maybe the sum, which is more accurate. Language. Oh. Right. So we have the population here. How do I get that as a final number? How many people speak Spanish in the world? Sum of. Yeah, exactly. Sum of population. Which is probably not right. What happened? No, no, it's actually correct. It's a percentage.
Right, yeah.
Yeah, that's what you were saying.
Yeah. No, I thought you were saying that's not the right amount of people in the world, but it's not because it's only people that speak Spanish.
Exactly.
So
how do I do that? Or first thing, how do I make a finder that will get me the sum of that? That will get me the amount of people speaking that. Oh yeah, sorry for the style problem. I haven't got used to that yet. So I have the query. How do I tell the query do something in the future or do an after find? Someone told me the answer before. It was format result. Let me return it here. Okay. Now, what should I do there? How do I get the count of total speakers? Any idea? I'm going to give you the half of the answer. Okay, what is E here? It's the entity. Let me rename it to something that makes more sense. It's a country. Country with language. To be more precise. Yeah, so I just return country with language population times country with language. I don't have enough space, so need to improvise. We have it here in matching data languages. So matching data languages.
You also have to multiply, or I'm sorry, divide the percentage by.
Yeah. Percentage. Divided 100. Okay. So I do this. I have this query. Query, find speaking Spanish. I need to the table. Find people speaking Spanish, and then I do query. Find total speakers. Only an array is allowed for collection. It's because we didn't. Oh yeah, we didn't do that. I need to return one result. And only one. Whoopsie. Countries speaking. Total speakers first, and this is if the result. Does it make sense? No? What doesn't make sense? Exactly. So, to array. Actually, I make that mistake. Sorry. I should have gotten the right result. Maybe there's really few people speaking the language.
Would you have to iterate the results?
No, it's being iterated by sumof.
Okay.
Yeah. And it's only one. Oh, sorry. And this is a nice catch about the queries. Traversable where? Country stable. Speaking and then total speakers all first. Where? Ah, well, sorry. This is something that we removed before and we need, because format results should either return a collection or an array with the results. Always. So there's no escape to that. You cannot return just one result, one element. You need to return all the elements. Or, sorry, an array of elements. Oops. Speaking, total speakers. And there we go. Which is a lot of people. It's like 300 million people. So, do you see any problem doing that? This is my first step at doing a count like that. How else can we do it? Can we do it with SQL? Yes. Would you like to do it with SQL? No? Okay. Well, it was going to be an example of how to use custom expressions, but then no. Sorry? Yeah, this is actually quite fast, so, but definitely my SQL is gonna be way faster at doing the count, especially because you don't have to fetch root results, convert them, and then sum them. Okay. So let's implement this, but using SQL. So I'm gonna create another function with public function, find. Total speakers, SQL, whatever. Query and options. So it returns query. Select. So let's build our expression here. What should it do? How would it get the sum of the population multiplied by the percentage divided by 100? So the expression start with this, which is query. Function sum of, well, we have it here, we have population multiplied by languages, well, it's actually percentage, it's a safe column there, percentage divided by 100. Yeah, I don't need to prefix it in this case. It's a good thing to do it, but I'm not going to do it because I don't have enough space in the screen. But population is unique in the tables that I have selected, and percentage is same, so it's safe. Why can I do that? Even though it's from another table, because I use matching. So since I did an inner join, I have all the columns in the same structure. So what I do here is total is this expression. And I return the query. which is nicer because it's only two lines versus a chain of returns here. So countries, speaking Spanish, total speakers equal. And now I don't need to, well, yeah, all first. It's actually country. Here I should get the total. We're going to discuss that in a minute. We get the same number. Or, well, similar. It is similar because, and it's actually another reason to use SQL instead of PHP is that float management in PHP is. It's not that good. So when you're summing stuff, for example, when you're going to invoice someone, try to do it directly in the database because you might end up losing money. You will, exactly. Someone from Fresh Food talking. Okay, this is actually annoying that I have to do, like I have a countries, or a country entity, and then I have to get the total there. How do I just get an array instead of an entity? Yes, but that would create the entity and then extract the field from the entity. Okay, you say hydrate false, and then you get the first one. And you get that array.
That essentially makes it return what cake 2 would
return. Yeah, with the difference that the associations would be nested in a tree okay. instead of in the same level as cake 2.
Okay. Oh, that's better. That's
cool. Yeah, of course, it's super cool.
Can you explain what hydrate does in general in
tree? Hydrate. Well, hydrate currently only have two modes, which is true and false. It could have more, but in this case, it's true means the results of this query, I want them to be entities, so objects. And the false mode means I don't want entities, I want an array representation of the entity. Well, actually, different than that. I just want the results as they come from the database without going to the entity first. For example, remember our speaking language, Spanish. Let's do that again. And now we do query. Hydrate false to array. Whoops. Now we get arrays and you cannot see actually you cannot see the entities, the word entity anywhere. You just get, hey, nice. You just get simple arrays. Make sense? With the difference in Cake 2 that you get the correct types. Here would be a float. Here would be an integer. Here is a datetime, because that's what maps to the database. Okay. Any questions so far? Going slow for some people? Raise your hand if you think I'm slowing you down. No? Too fast for some people? No? So perfect. That's amazing. Good. So what other questions can we ask to the world database? We already know countries that speak a particular language, English or Spanish in this case, that we just said. What other questions can we do?
Just real quick, if I wanted to just scan a list of the percentages of the Spanish-speaking countries that I just returned, just
just from the fine sweeping, is there a way to just pull that out of the result set?
Sure. So you have this fine speaking Spanish. So query. You just want a list?
Yeah, let's say I just want to scan.
So I can extract. Matching data dot languages dot percentage. List. If you want it per language, then you just use combine instead. What only one? Oh, sorry, yeah, of course. Because it's only Spanish. So what we actually wanted is per country. There you go. Mm-hmm. What it just did? In this case, the question, sorry for not repeating it. His question was, I have this query, which was country speaking Spanish, right? You remember that? If I do query to array, I get a list of countries, and they all speak Spanish. So his question was, how do I get, for example, a list of the percentages of the language of the population that speaks Spanish, right? So my first answer was extract. Extract will get a particular column from the result set and put it in a list. So for all 62 countries, I get their percentage, which is not very useful because I would at least want the name of the country. So what I did is instead of extract, I use combine. And then as key, I use the name of the country. And as value, I use the matching data, languages, percentage. Make sense?
Real quick question. In CakePHP 2, one of the conventions was underscores or private slash protected. Is that correct?
For controllers, yes. Well, for anything, yes. Well, yeah, it's still an internal convention, but you don't have to follow it. In the core, it is followed. So all protected methods have an underscore. We don't have privates. But yeah, it's still a convention. In the core, you're not forced to use it, especially because now with PSR2, the standard, the formatting standard says that you should not use underscore for signaling protected. So it's up to you. Well, it actually says that you should not use it. And if you do use it, then you should have a really good reason for that. And our really good user is that we don't want to change all our work. Great. So what other questions can we ask to the world database?
What are the most popular languages?
Most popular languages. So I'm going to do that from the languages table, OK?
What if I want to know which?
Yeah, popular by country, that would be.
Yeah, would say popular by number of countries or popular by population?
Yeah, exactly. What do you want? Okay, but still it's a question that you would ask to the language. What is the most popular language? So I think that conceptually it makes sense to have it in the languages table. So public function, find popular. So it gets a query and some options. And okay. Any idea how to do this? So let's structure our thinking and say, how do I find the most popular? How would I do it without cake? How do I get the most popular languages per population? Sounds simple. Sort descending by number of people speaking. Isn't it? And how do I get the number of people speaking a language? Exactly. So can we reuse that? That's a great question.
Yes.
So this and this no, this query contain countries. Function Q So the key is I want to reuse somehow the function from the countries that finds the total speaker that particular row or sum. I want to use it here. Right?
Yeah.
So I will return Q. Since this query comes from the countries table because it's inside contain countries, I can actually call this method find total speakers equal. Okay, so right now it will sort of work, but we have another problem. So I'm just going to leave it like this. So we get, just to make sure, we have a languages table belongs to countries, okay? So I'm totally allowed to do this. Remember that find total speakers depended on languages and countries being in the same select, so they should be joined, so I can get the sum. Let me try to use that and see what happens. To get languages. So languages, find, the name was popular, SQL. I want the SQL that is going to generate. Boom, that's not good. 1 second, languages, find, popular. I'm not returning, that's a problem.
You may have to find this in SQL on the function.
Where? Poly function find?
74.
Oh yeah, but that was not the problem. No. The problem was that I didn't return query here. Find popular. I'm gonna make the same mistake again so it reloads. Or I hope it does reload. Find popular. SQL. Let me see if it will reload. Languages. Find. Popular. SQL. No, it does not reload, so I need to do it manually. There you go. So I get languages. inner join count, and I have, apparently it works, right? I have this as total. So let's try to get to array. I get only one language. Why do I get only one language? The answer is here. They're not grouped, exactly. So the next thing that I need to do is that I need to group by languages, lang.id. Which apparently what do you mean? No, but well, is there an ID? There's no. So it's language is. Let me see. The primary country ID language. Perfect. Okay, just use language. To array. Now we have a lot of languages, which is great. And what is the last step? How do we make it return the popular stuff? Order. Order by total in descending order. Okay. I get that. So let me actually just combine the language with the total and to array. So the most popular is actually Chinese. Now, how do I get like top 10? Yeah, but should I add it here? That's not too bad. There you go. Is there any other way to write the same thing without using options? Exactly. That's a great question. Let's see. So if you want to answer that question, you use SQL and you see that, yes, it does add it to the SQL. There's actually no limit function in the collections. It's called take. So you can only take 10, take something, and take with an offset. So we answered most popular languages like immediately thanks to this function that we already made. So our biggest learning so far is that I can actually use custom finders in contain. Isn't that great? Yes, it is. Okay, any questions about contain so far? Apart from the load sys. Yeah.
I've seen instances where
you know, let's say I have, I use a contain with another table, right? And that table returns multiple rows. And let's say the table returns multiple rows of IDs, and I also want the name along with the IDs. So I've seen Cake execute individual queries to return those names.
Yeah, that's gone.
So in this, it would be
the yeah, well, his question was that, for example, you have a collection of articles, and you have their comments. And, well, yeah, and you have authors. So you find all authors and their articles. And then you also contain comments. So what happens in Cake 2 is that it would do a selection on authors, a select on articles, passing all the IDs from authors. But then when it gets to the point of comments, it will do one query per comment to get the comments. So one query per article. But that's gone in Cake 3. It will try to batch as much as possible the finds. So it's quite cool. Okay. What time is it, by the way? 3:45. We have a break at 4, right? Yes, okay. So in 15 minutes, has anyone actually downloaded the data set? A few people? If you haven't done it, try to do it. Try to bake the application. I'm going to leave here is CakePHP 3 examples. You download it in config. Boo. Well, it is in config schema world.sql. Try to load that. And you will try to make a finder that is called find cities bigger than, and you pass a country name. So that means that the population of that city should be bigger than a whole country in population. Okay? So I'll give you 15 minutes to do that, and I'll give you the answer after the break, actually. And if you have questions, just let me know. I'll be around.
Being called from the cover.
No, I have a user ID on it, right? So inside the cars, I have a user ID. So all I want to show you is I did that. I did that. My conditional. I think so.
how are you people doing? Any questions? Do you at least download the data set? Okay.
I just want to return this score to whoever lent this to me.
Okay, yes, we're here. Do you know who?
No, I don't know.
Okay.
Who was the person who lent me this phone charger?
Who's the Pace guy?
The Pace University guy.
Okay, then I'll return that to him.
All right, thanks.
Thanks.
No problem.
Do you need that? No? Yeah, I saw that. You tell me where should I start? There? I actually didn't remember I had that.
It was one day, it's like, I need to fill the database with like a blob text quickly to test like a skeleton. And I got it from Samuel L. Gibson.
Oh, Samuel. That's what I said.
So it's 4 already, so if you want to have some snacks, there's food outside, and have some drinks as well, non-alcoholic. Hello. Welcome back. Guys, how many of you managed to answer the question? Get close to it. Dakota. So, Walter, how do I do it? Guide me. In what table did you create the finder? In the cities table. And you managed to answer the question as well?
Yeah, kind of,
okay. Let's go to cities. Because conceptually, the question was find cities which are bigger than X, so it makes sense to ask directly the table repository, the cities repository. So public function find bigger than query options. So if empty options, it's like an array. Country, then throw new invalid argument exception. You need to provide a country. There you go. So now. You create a subquery. Okay, this countries find select population. Okay, where ID he prefix it countries dot ID equals options country. Anything else? Limit one. Return sub return query where cities dot population greater than the subquery. That sounds correct. Any questions about this answer? Why does you need a limit one? That's a good question. Why do you need a limit one, Walter? Exactly. The reason is this operator here. It requires that the result from this is a specific number. It cannot be a group of numbers. If I do like a contain with countries, you mean? Yeah, it would. A matching, to be more precise. That this is a version. Sorry? This here? It doesn't need to be an expression because the query is already an expression. Your question is this. This is equivalent. You can say function. It returns receives an expression, and I can return here expression greater than cities.population, comma, use subquery. So that was your question? Yeah, you can do that, of course, but there's no benefit at all. It just makes it unreadable, harder to read. This is completely fine. And the advantage is that this is not executed. It's just a query object. So when I pass it here, it will actually just do more than a subquery. So I'm not losing anything, and I'm gaining on readability. So that's a great answer, Walter. Thank you. Let's test it out. So cross your fingers. So it would be cities. Let's do it manually. Cities equals t get cities. So cities. Let me find what is Denmark here. D F. D and K. So cities find bigger than country D and K to array. I just use PJ. There you go. So cities that are bigger in population than Denmark. We have Sao Paulo, Rio de Janeiro, London, Cairo, Jakarta, Shanghai, of course, et cetera, et cetera. And New York. Huh. So New York is bigger than Denmark. That's amazing. So any questions about his answer. Let's look at it again. Do you find or do you encounter any problems while trying to come up with the solution? So no problems? Is a way to solve it with, yes. Do you want me to do that as well? So function, public function. Find bigger than 2, or version 2. Query options. I'm gonna skip the validation part. So let's return query matching countries, which is actually no need because countries are inner join already because of the belongs to. But let's just have the matching anyway. Function Q. So actually no, not from cities. You can do that from countries, the matching.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Yeah, let's do that. So it would be countries smaller than, or smaller than a city, okay? So matching cities. So, and the condition for matching is that the countries, sorry, the population of the country should be less well, there's a problem here. Yeah, one second. If I say this, what is the problem they're gonna find? If I do this, find cities where their population is less than the population of the city. What is the main problem with this? No, because the matching is actually matching the cities from that country. And if I do this, it's not possible because the population of a country obviously includes the population of the cities. What we can do is using a left join. Should we go that way? Yes? Let's just convert this to left join. Left join or inner join, I don't know. This is the alias of the table. This is the actual table. And these are the conditions that I'm going to pass to that thing. The conditions that are not for a left join, are not a query, are an expression. So I return the expression. Expression at this. So countries that are smaller than any city that it can find. Does it make sense so far?
Yeah.
Okay. So let me go back. Trying to get countries. Countries. So countries, find smaller than, well, it's particular city, right? Or smaller than any city for now. So if to make this query make any sense for us, I'm gonna select the countries dot name and the cities dot name. So it will have a pair of the country name is smaller than city name. Okay. So countries find smaller than, let's see the SQL for this. So we get name and the city's name. Let me give an alias here. City name. There you go. From countries, left join cities where countries.population is less than cities.population. So let's see what happens. Let's do the PJs of this. It's gonna be long. Let me just limit. Oops. There you go. So Aruba is smaller than Kabul. Anguilla is smaller than Kabul as well. Andorra is, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So if we make this different and we use here options and just pass this particular city name, options. Add and equals cities dot name options city. Okay. Get this smaller than New York city. New York. Let me remove the limit. And I get it now. So this is the list of countries. Whoops. Maybe that's not correct. Here, Aruba is, yeah, makes sense. Yeah, it does make sense. Yeah, it's correct. I just for some reason saw one of that didn't make sense, so I'm just looking at it. No, this doesn't make sense. Yeah, because United States minus outlying islands, it cannot be smaller than New York, right? Let me see. Yeah. Well, the reason is an inner join, exactly. That's the reason for the nulls. Okay. But this one doesn't make any sense. Oh, okay. Yeah, yeah, okay, yeah, that's true. Yeah, okay. Of course. Okay, okay. So, yeah. So, there are a lot of countries that are smaller than New York. That's what I couldn't believe, but apparently. So, yeah, this is a way of doing it without a subquery. It depends on your database. I guess if you use MySQL less than 5.6, this will be more performant than his solution. Of course, this is a different question, right? He's smaller than, the other is more than. But using a subquery is okay most of the times. If you use something like MySQL 5.6 or MariaDB, the latest one, or Postgres or SQL Server, anything not MySQL 5.5. Right? Well, Mark is not here. Good. Any question about this one? I want you to notice that I did this. I had to alias it. I had to give an alias to something in the join, because otherwise that column will not be placed anywhere in the result set. Make sense? If I alias it, it will be put into the main entity. Okay, so he asked about callbacks before. Let's add a callback to the countries table. I don't know that if it can detect. And you want to do the filter on SQL or in plain PHP? In PHP. So his request is, let's do a filter, a callback, that once I get the results, it will filter countries by their language. Okay? So I don't want to show countries speaking Spanish for some reason. I don't like them. So, public function. What is the callback that I should use for that? Okay, it's before find. Why is before find? Because after find doesn't exist. So that's pretty straightforward. So I receive a query. I actually receive an event, and a query, and some options. There's actually a fourth param, but we don't need it now. And what it tells, it requires me, well, it actually doesn't need me to return anything, but I can alter the query here. I want to format results. And it pass function. Which get the results, and I need to at some point return the results. Okay. How do I filter? No, but that would be in SQL. You asked me to remove them in PHP. I got to iterate the results and remove those that have a specific thing. Yeah. So what I will do is results reject. I'm going to return a collection that will reject results that match some condition. So here this will be a country. And I need to return a reject condition, which is that country get languages, because it's more than one. Extract language contains Spanish. Exactly. Yeah, what I'm going to do is, like, sometimes there might not be a language because I don't always do contain. So I'm going to get the languages here. And just convert it to an array. So here I do collection of languages. Okay. So here I extract the language name, and if it contains Spanish, the list of languages that that country speaks, it will return true, which means it should be rejected. And well, let's try that. So I'm actually going to return here before, just to see the before and after. Countries, so countries contain languages. I need to define first to array. So here I have, I think this is Aruba. They speak like five languages there. Dutch, English, Papiamento, and Spanish. So this would be a good one, because if I remove this return, Aruba should not be the first one. Countries contained to array. I have a problem, which is I didn't return somewhere. Sorry? No, I don't actually need to return query here. So let me see. Call to a function array on a non-object. Oh, well, yes, of course, because no, actually reject should not do that. Let's see what it does. To array, I have that. Let me see, what's the first one? First one is a country. So let me do PJ of that. Okay, so I know what I did wrong. I need to do contain all to array. Well, just first. There you go. So the first one should not be Aruba, it's Afghanistan. And it doesn't have Spanish. Looks simple, doesn't it? Any other question about callbacks? Can you find any other example of filtering, removing, adding? Changing radically the way you should present the results. Some actual example that you had in any application, like when did you use an afterfind before? What would be the reason for using an afterfind? Modify the results, okay. Maybe inject another column. Remove. Well, yeah, but it's the same logic, right? So if, for example, I don't know, there's curse words, of course, in the quote that you saw. Sorry about that. That was a early test that he had. Let's not do remove curse word because it's the same as the same logic. It's like reject, you get the curse words and then you just return true or false depending of the presence of the word. Which I probably wouldn't do it in PHP anyway.
Just one question.
That's okay. Is it working with the results after they are fetched from the database? So nothing is added to the SQL after that.
Did the port find, in this particular case, it's after the results are fetched, right? Because you use format results.
Yeah, format results is basically like, in the future, do this. It's like a callback for the future for in the query.
If I used pure SQL, like, you know, the other thing, then it would happen even before the query is executed.
If I do what, sorry? No, well, the SQL will only be executed when the SQL is executed. So if you add it here, for example, here we added a column, that's added to the SQL.
Yeah.
And it will be executed in the database. And then when the results are fetched, that particular column will be present in the result set. So no extra processing needed to be done in our side. Exactly. So for people that come from Cake2, what would be the advantage of having format results versus having an afterfind globally in the table?
You can do a one-off.
Exactly. So for each find smaller than or find total speakers, in this particular case, this is my one-off. So only for this particular query, I want these results formatted in that specific way. So that's why I tell you that the query can be seen as a command. It's a command object. So you create a command, you construct a command that says, well, when you're executed, the results will be formatted in this way. But not only do it when it's actually executed. And only do it for this particular case. This case, I have never done it in my life. The life of Cake3. which is putting a format result in before find. I correct myself, I have done it. Actually, the translate behavior does that. The translate behavior, after finding the results, it will format them in a before find to put the translations in the correct places. So yeah. I have done it, but I have never done it in an application. So it's usually like some meta stuff that you're doing. It's not something that you would do all the time. Why do I do before find instead of after find? Because after find doesn't exist. So that's the only reason. And after find doesn't exist because it's a way of us discouraging you to add global logic to something that you have no idea what it's doing. So if you ever did any after finding Cake2, you would probably agree they were a nightmare. You always got different formats of the results. Sometimes it was a find count. Sometimes it was something with structure. Sometimes it was the result of a contain. So you were never sure what was happening. But in this case, format results, you're always sure to what query you're actually calling it. So the after find, it's a way of us to say, please don't add global things to the query like that, like global formatting. So someone asked me if we could. Oh no, that was my idea, sorry. Do you want to add any other format results to this? Or any other thing? Yeah?
What if I want to reuse the format results?
Okay, so let's come up with a real use case for that.
I want to get the actual number of people for every country. I want the actual number of people to speak that language.
Can you repeat that? Let me see. That's great. That's a great idea. Okay, so query format results function results return results map. Okay, so here we just basically need to check if country languages. I'm actually going to use the array notation, which is possible to do also in entities. And the reason I do that is because it will both work when you do hydrate false and when you do hydrate true, which is a default. So I tend to use always array notation for that reason. So if not that, return country. But if there is languages, there are any languages, I want to say that country, oh, sorry. So for each languages or country languages. Well, actually don't need to do that. I can just use it. Slang. Total speakers equals lang dot percentage divided by 100 times country population. Not enough space, so let me put this thing below. Does it make sense? Where? 182 languages.
You have to pass the reference, right?
Sorry?
It'll not update the.
I'm not following.
On 186 lang.
Lang, yeah. You know that I have never been able to write default correctly? Oh, first time. I usually do that. You can see that in the commit logs of CakePHP a lot. 186 what? Languages. What is the problem now?
The spelling of the key, and does lang need to be passed by reference?
No, because it's an object. Well, yeah, but let's pass it by reference because it could be an array. Yeah, yeah. Sorry about that. I had it correctly, then someone convinced me it was incorrect, and your guys are the worst. Okay, so let's try that. Yeah, well, it's not necessary right now because I'm using entities. So the object is going to be always the same object. So that was okay. But if I do hydrate false, which this is going to be an array. Yeah, it's going to be an array. And as I want to change that array in particular, then I need a reference. But this reference will work both for arrays and objects, so it's fine to use. So find, what is the name of my finder? Just find whatever, find, contain, languages. To array. Or just, let me use PJ. And a limit 10. So now I have the countries here and the languages, and each language now has total speakers and the amount of speakers of that particular language. This makes absolutely no sense. That's the data set that I got. Oh, okay, that's interesting. No, that doesn't make any sense. So in the Netherlands until the official language is Dutch, but no one speaks it. Yeah. But that's the way you do it. And what is interesting as well is that both callbacks ran. So the format results here was run. So it removed all the Spanish-speaking countries, and it added the amount of people speaking that particular language. In what other way can we do the same?
Is there an existing method to sort out large numbers into three and then a comma, three, number format?
Yeah, it's called number format. Let's do that. So let me bake bean cake bake controller countries and the template for countries. So bean cake server port 8087. So if I go to countries, okay, let me fix that quick. No. Countries controller. I don't need capitals here. There you go. Here you can see that the population has commas, because that's the way Americans would format their numbers for some reason. As opposed to the rest of the world. where does that come from? If we go to index CDP in countries, you can see that number format of surface area, independence year, population. That's what it does. That's a helper. It's actually a class, so you can actually do cake IHNN number format. It should be the same. Yeah. So in this you can use, for example, in an email or in whatever class that you're using, whereas the helper, you should be using it in the views. Up to you. So it doesn't matter. This is a bit of detour, but no one has asked me how do I change the commas to something that is not crazy American. Yeah. How do I do that? Yeah. So you go to Bootstrap and you get to decide what is your main country, right? So if you're here in the US, you would probably benefit from this default, but I happen to live in Denmark, so I want the ADK. So if I reload, magic. And well, something that is great about this is that, for example, in the countries table, in the countries controller, you detect, the user that is actually visiting this page, he comes from the US. So you use cake IHNN, and you say IHNN local is NUS. And you can change it on the fly. And of course, you can put an if around that, if the user. Actually, Cake provides something for that. It's called the local dispatcher filter or something like that. It detects the header that the browser sends. Like, I want this in English. And it automatically calls that function with the right local. So you should see the numbers and the dates. Oh yeah, did you see the date, by the way? Let me see. Do we have any dates at all? Capitals again. And record not finding countries. For real? Of course. Because Aruba speaks Spanish, so it was streamed out of the result set. Date, I think I had a date. Okay, create and modify it. It has this format, which, if I'm not mistaken, is the one from Denmark. And you can go here and change it back to the US, and now you get crazy again. Yeah. I was going to cover IHNN later, but it was a nice detour. Do you have any questions about that? The feature that I just showed? So the conclusion that we can get out of this is try to avoid as much as possible to have presentational stuff in your tables and in your entities. So having, I have seen this a lot. For example, in countries, country.php, they say, oh, nice. Entities will get me what I want. Public, I'm not sure if it's protected, actually. Protected. Get population. return, it receives the population. Population. Return cake ihnn number format population. So I have seen this. Let me protect it function. Let me remove from population the number formatting. It still works, right? If I remove that function here in the entity, you just call it double underscore. It's not formatted. Sorry. If I do this, it is formatted. But why should I not do that? That's a great thing. And you were going to say something else?
Yeah, it's modifying your original data set. So if you just need an integer, it's no longer.
Exactly. So if you want to do operations, for example, like a one, like summing the populations, it's going to mess it up. And there's one really important thing, is that the process of saving actually calls the getters. So if you pass a formatted number to the database, it would probably say, oh, this is like this is our decimals when it should be thousands. And then you lose money and your clients fire you, whatever. So don't do this. If you want to format or have formatters in your entities, which is not what I would do, you say get formatted population. And in the index, for example, you do formatted population. Sorry?
Making it essentially a virtual field.
It is a virtual field, exactly. Formatted population. Oh yeah. Doesn't receive anything, and it should be this population. There you go.
So now it's a virtual field, but before, because it had the same namespace, it wasn't a virtual field?
It is not a virtual field. It's like a. It's a getter. Exactly. It protects the field from being accessed directly, and it should always go through that function. Which is great for value objects, which is something that we're going to see maybe tomorrow or in my talk on Sunday.
So you said you would advise to do that, right?
The proper way is to not do this, not have formatting methods in the entity, but to actually do it directly in the view. Well, it's a helper, right? It's number format.
Right. But you could encapsulate that, create a helper to draw that table. So you could reuse that same table code over and over again, but you only have to write the format code once, and then that you just pass it the entity and then it'll run through and create that table, and you can use that same code everywhere. So it achieves the same idea of putting that code in the entity, but it's in the right place. Right?
Yeah. So another way is to use value objects. So can you do you know what value objects are? Or have a rough idea of what they are? Someone? You were saying yes, so you will have to speak. Key value pairs. Yeah, sort of. A value object is an object, an instance of a class that represents something specific and is not mutable. For example, a gender or a date. Yeah. Dates, unfortunately, in PHP are mutable, but that's not the case. A gender is immutable, so you can hardly, in the computer system, say, well, this gender, this object in particular, transform it from male to female. You would better assign a different sex. If there was a transgender person, you would assign a different gender to that object instead of mutating the concept of male or mutating the concept of female. So one example in cake of a value object are dates. So dates are daytime objects or time objects. So they embed some logic, so they when they are echoed, they do something, right? There's some specific logic to do the echoing, or they have formatting functions. Okay. So you have you can see here. That I can use an object, that a value object as, or I can make it have functions to do the formatting. So you don't have to do the formatting in the entity. You could either have a helper or you could have the formatting logic embedded into a value object. Does that make sense? Gender, an address, an email, an URL, anything, right? Actually, it can vary. Money can be a value object.
That one is a magic one that Cake already knows how to do, right?
Yeah.
What other ones does Cake provide?
That's the only one. Yeah. You can create your own, and probably in the future, Cake will provide more. As that idea is being explored, my talk on Sunday would be actually about, well, not only, but a part of that would be how to add a gender value object to your app, and what are the benefits of doing that. Can you repeat or speak louder?
I know there are thoughts about moving away from Kaggle.
Yeah.
Because I know the times the Kaggle
are. Yes.
So do you guys intend to keep all the
Kaggle
functions?
Yes, yes. It would be exactly the same API. And it would probably extend Carbon in a tricky way, so you don't lose the... If you were depending on that at some point, it will actually appear that it implements Carbon. But yeah, he's saying that. Let me show you here. Do you know what Carbon is? Yeah, Carbon is a library for dates, basically. When I do countries. Fine. First, created, I get a time object. But a time object, if I ask created instance of carbon, is true. So it is a carbon object. That is a library that Cake depends on that provides super neat stuff like give me the year of created. Give me the month of created. Or the day. Stuff like that. It can also do like diff in seconds of, I don't know, new time. New day time. So how long ago was it? Must be an instance of carbon. Yeah, go figure. Carbon. So this is the diff in seconds since that record was created. Create diff in months. Diff in. Damn. Okay, diff in months, right? So it was created 8 months ago. And it has a extremely large amount of methods. I don't know if I have internet. Well, Just look like a PHP carbon in Google, and you find like has hundreds and hundreds of way of accessing stuff from your date objects and subtracting them, adding months, adding seconds. It's way cool. But Cake is going probably to not use that anymore. It's going to have exactly the same functions, the same functionality, but because that library is being started to introduce new dependencies, we prefer to give a like tighter hold on where it's going. Yeah. So my question here was, how else can I add a total speakers count to the languages? Yeah, I can do it in the entity directly. Is that what you said?
Yeah.
Now, for now, I will just leave it here, because it serves the purpose of working both for entities and for arrays. So I think that's a good example to leave in the code. Okay. Let's do something now. Has anyone already downloaded all the data set? Sorry. Yeah. So you will have another assignment, I think, for the last for the next 15 minutes. So I can give an the answer 15 minutes later. We're gonna work with CSV files, not load them, but we're gonna export them. I want you to create a shell. If you don't know how to create a shell, I will do it here, so you can follow me. And the shell needs to export the country, or all the countries, with their official language and the amount of people that speak that language as a column. So all the columns from a country, all the columns from the official language, and how many people speak that language in particular. Is that okay? And I need a CSV file of that. Sounds complex?
What were the fields again? One more time?
All the fields from countries. All the fields from the official language. The official language is actually just a variable here in here. Languages. You have official somewhere. Is official T, okay? And how many people speak that language in that country? And I need that CSV file. No, assume one. Yeah. And that means if you do like a matching or something like that, that will repeat the row, that will repeat the country, is fine. So for people that do not know how to bake a shell or create a shell, cake, bake, shell, export. Now I have an export shell. And it's located in source, shell, export. And I have a main method here. So here is where you need to export a CSV file with those columns. By the way, the CSV file needs to have the column titles as first line. So I'm going to start answering the question. How far do you get? It's like, do you create a shell at least? Great. So the first thing is to create a finder. That's what we need. So I'm going to countries equals this load model. Countries, find, contain, official language, and that's it. So results equals country. If I do PJ countries bean cake sport There should be more. Oh yeah, that's true. Okay, that's extremely weird, but yeah. Let's just call all. Countries not associated with official languages. There you go. I have official language here. And I need the count of people per language. So I wanted to reuse this, but I probably won't be able. Because official language is just one. I'm gonna hack it for now, because let's make it as many. So because what I wanted to show is if it has many, okay? So I can I do export results, and now it's at an array, okay? So what I wanted to show was in the countries table, we have this logic here. Countries table here. We have this logic, right? And it says languages, but I want it to be also for official languages. So what can I do? I'm going to do this. I'm going to create a folder there in source. It's called model formatter. And I'm going to create a class in source model formatter called total speakers. So PHP namespace app model formatter. So class total speakers. Function public function invoke, so it's a callable function. It receives a row. And it does this. One for a second. I'm going to copy this here. So instead of countries, I do row, 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 row. And I want this to be configurable. So I add a constructor, public function construct. And it receives the field name that it should look for. This field equals field. Protected field. So instead of using languages directly, I use field. Field. Whoops. I do the same here. This field, total speakers, lang, percentage, row, population. Thank you. Are you following what I'm doing? So now here in countries, instead of using the function, the mac function, I do new total speakers of languages. And I actually do, again, the same. I do total speakers, but from official languages. So I duplicated the logic without creating a mess. And I need to import the function. Use app model formatter total speakers. Sort. Okay, does it make sense so far? And now I'm gonna use it here. Here, PJ results. Let me see if it works. It does work. I have total speakers. I have duplicated some logic by using a callable class with a double underscore method, a invoke method. Were you familiar with invocable classes before? Well, they are cool. They're exactly like the closures, but where you would use the use keyword, you have the constructor. And they totally look cool because they're like named functions, because you can read what they're doing now. Instead of guessing what they're doing by reading the code in the closure, you read the name, it says, oh, okay, it's actually injecting the total speakers into the result set. So now the final step is to export the CSV. So what we're going to do is so result. I'm going to get the first result. Okay. And I'm going to create what it needs is the two array of this first result, debug first. I get this. And what I want from that is the array keys of that. Now we have the column names except for official languages. So official is first results first official languages to array keys of that. So I want first plus official it's an array already, so no need. Well, actually I'm just gonna get the first, which is what we assumed in the beginning. Expected object given. It is an object indeed, so to array. There you go. Now, whoops. Array merge. So now I have the titles for the CSV. I just need to remove this one. So Just convert it to collection. So the titles are this here. Right? Official languages. Fine. So now we have, fuck my life. I need to return, sorry. There you go. I have the titles now. So how do I export to CSV? Ideas? Nope. So yes, exactly. So we create the file. It's new SPL file object. Let me put it in temp dot countries dot CSV. So for each result as country, file fput CSV. There you go, file. Sorry, titles. And then for each one, file fput CSV country extract. First, I need to remove just say country. Oh, no, no. Just do it here. So first plus country, put it on another line, country get, or just official languages, zero, extract official. Without this. And that should probably be it. Make sense? Actually, I need to W plus. It does. Because cake file is not an SPL file object, so I want to use an SPL file object so I can directly write CSV into it. So I just pass the array with data, and it will work. Most probably, yes, 36 official languages. So if it's not zero, what is it?
Oh, isn't that an object?
Yeah, but it must be that some country that doesn't have an official language. Indeed. So countries, filter. We just reject. It's not countries, it's results. There you go. Now if I see less temp country CSV, I have my answer. And that's all for today. If you have any questions about how I exported in an awesome way a CSV file, actually this can be written with less lines, but I don't have enough time to go over the process. Basically what you would do is instead of using a for each, you put that inside an each for the collection, and instead of doing this before iterating the collection, you do it as another map that only runs once. And that's it. So you can use this for a lot of things. So at work, I work a lot with shells that export stuff and import stuff from other places. And it is great that you have like a pipeline of work that you can say, well, this part I already did it in some other shell, so I'm just going to put it inside a map. New, import this from other place. And then you iterate. Like you have like these reusable parts of exporters or importers from a collection. Any questions about what I just did? No? Well, thank you guys for today.
So did everyone enjoy today? Yeah. Thank you.
este es el array. El conector. El conector.
El conector.
De videos del array. No sé qué se hizo.
¿Qué conector?
El de VGA, de laptop a VGA.
No, sí, nos vamos, pero hay que esperar que el Larry le deje de dejar la mano.
Gracias.